Good day and welcome to Big Bad Tech. I'm your instructor, Jim Pytel. During this short application exercise, we're going to examine some hypothetical troubleshooting scenarios using the three-wire magnetic motor starter we created in a prior applications exercise. Before we begin, realize the first step to troubleshooting any system is to understand how it is intended to operate. Anyone that tells you anything different is wrong. This lecture therefore operates under the presumption you have watched the preceding lectures detailing the principle of operation and construction of the three-wire magnetic motor starter. Keep in mind, there is no limit to the wrong that can happen. Problems manifest themselves in many numbers and in many forms, and sometimes the same external symptom can be rooted in very different sources. This being said, we'd like to discuss and intentionally induce some faults in this circuit for the purposes of familiarizing you with the observed results. If at a later date you observe these same fault conditions, you'll at least have the luxury of having seen it once before. Recall our three-wire magnetic motor starter implemented in the above-referenced lectures used a maintain contact e-stop, a momentary contact stop push button, a momentary contact start push button, an auxiliary holding contact, and a normally closed overload contact to control the operation of a unidirectional motor. When an operator presses and releases start, the motor energizes and continues to rotate in one direction. When an operator presses and releases stop, the motor free spins to a halt. If an operator observed an unsafe scenario, the e-stop disables the system until it is reset. You should realize that this circuit exhibits certain expected behaviors that, although potentially undesirable, are not to be considered troubleshooting events, but are rather byproducts of the as-constructed nature of this circuit. A technician knowledgeable of basic technical principles and the circuit's intended function can predict this behavior and take the necessary precautions. Note the control transformer wired between the circuit breaker and the manual motor starter is not expressly illustrated in this primary circuit. With this consideration, consider the response of this system to a sudden loss and restoration of power or an overload event. Recall that three-wire circuits exhibit low or no voltage protection characteristics, and that if power is lost and restored, the system will not immediately restart until an operator makes the conscious decision to do so. Consider what happens in run mode when the circuit breaker opens, simulating a loss of both pilot and primary power to the whole system. As predicted, the motor free spins to a halt. When power is restored to the whole system, the motor does not immediately return to the run mode since the holding circuit is dropped out. An operator must therefore actively press the start button to return the motor to run mode. Low or no voltage protection circuits like this one are commonly employed in scenarios where an operator may be injured or an industrial process damaged by the unexpected restart of a motor. Let us now explore the limitations of low or no voltage protection. Low or no voltage protection circuits necessitate the pilot holding circuit drop out for this feature to function. If power is restored to the whole system the moment an operator happens to be pressing the start button, this system could still suddenly restart, as would an ordinary two-wire control circuit when the automatic input is still being triggered. By no means are these systems foolproof. And, given the large population of fools you work with, you must take necessary precautions when working on systems where your safety is of primary concern. For this reason, lockout and tagout procedures are vitally important. Similarly, consider a scenario in which only primary power to the motor is lost. However, the pilot level ladder logic remains functional. When the system is placed in run mode by an operator pressing and releasing start, the holding circuit is established. When the manual motor starter downstream of the control transformer is opened, the de-energized motor obviously free spins to a halt. Note, however, the pilot level ladder logic provided by the still energized control transformer downstream of the closed circuit breaker and upstream of the open manual motor starter remains energized. The contactor coil remains energized and the contacts remain closed. If these clues are subtle enough to escape your attention, note the pilot light remains illuminated, indicating the pilot level ladder logic is maintaining the holding circuit. The moment the manual motor starter is closed, the motor springs to life. Let this be a lesson you hopefully never have to learn again. Low or no voltage protection has its limits, and a technician knowledgeable of these limits can take the necessary means to protect themselves. Again, for this reason, lockout and tagout procedures are vitally important. Let's now consider this three-wire magnetic motor starter's response to an overload event caused either by a mechanical load, a locked rotor, or a single-phasing event. Consider what would happen if the overload relay was in the automatic reset mode. In this case, I'm simulating an overload event by pushing in the manual test button. The triggered overload element signals the contactor to open as expected. When the overload element in automatic mode cools and resets, when I stop triggering it, the system does not immediately start since the holding circuit is dropped out. Only when an operator makes a conscious decision to do so by actively pressing and releasing start does it do so. The system's response to an overload event is somewhat different when the overload is placed in the manual reset mode. Here I've simulated a single-phasing event by removing one leg of a three-phase AC system. When I press and release start, as anticipated, after a predictable measure of time, the overload triggers and opens the contactor. When the overload element is given a chance to cool, it does not automatically reset, but rather remains open since it is in manual reset mode. When the source of the overload is removed, in this case all three phases are functional, as can be anticipated, the start button will not energize the contactor coil since the normally closed overload contact in manual reset mode is still open. Only when a technician acknowledges the overload event and manually resets the overload will the system return to service. Keep in mind, a service call immediately following the removal of the overload-inducing event may be because someone simply forgot to reset the overload in manual mode. Note for both modes, automatic reset and manual reset, the overload should be trip-free, meaning it cannot be held closed while the overload elements are still hot. Let's examine some additional hypothetical troubleshooting scenarios and discuss how this system responds positively or negatively to these situations. Let's say the holding circuit provided by the normally open M1A auxiliary contact is not properly wired. When an operator presses and holds start, the motor starts. However, the moment the operator releases the start push button, the M1 contactor opens and the motor free spins to a halt. Quite obviously, this is the fault of an improperly established holding circuit that fails to maintain the last asserted state. This brief excitation of a motor without a holding contact is sometimes known as an inching or jogging action, a phenomenon we'll detail in later lectures that can be used to briefly move an applied load. While potentially advantageous for certain scenarios, repeated jogging events place stress on the contacts and could potentially trigger the overload elements early. We'll examine the peculiarities of jogging or inching behavior in later lectures on magnetic motor starters with jogging. Most likely, the source of the lost holding contact problem is an open wire. Very often, a visual inspection will quickly reveal the wire at fault. Most likely, the wire was inserted into the proper terminal, however, it wasn't fully secured and came out when the push-button station was closed. Systems having undergone some form of unexpected movement or cumulative vibration might exhibit this sudden loss of functionality. Keep in mind you need not immediately resort to intensive instrument-based troubleshooting, but rather a simple visual inspection should do the job. For this reason, properly labeling all wires with their appropriate number is a recommended practice. When peering into a push-button station and greeted by a clearly unlanded wire with a clearly labeled wire number, you can rest assured that this is the source of your problem. Sometimes it isn't that easy, and very often correct wires inserted in correct terminals just aren't making electrical contact. For this reason, good work practices dictate you properly strip and secure wires and tighten them to the manufacturer's recommended torque specification. This is doubly important when landing multiple wires at a single terminal. For this reason, permanent, more complex installations often make use of terminal blocks to make access and troubleshooting more convenient. Let's examine the nature of the holding circuit and discuss its implications. Let's say the control transformer has a blown fuse and cannot properly energize the M1 contactor coil. In this case, primary power to the motor is still available, it's just the pilot ladder logic will not function. A technician can, however, manually override the malfunctioning pilot level ladder logic and manually force the contactor closed. Warning: do not try this at home. For obvious reasons, this is not the preferred method when dealing with larger, more complicated systems, necessitating coordination and relying upon safety-critical interlocks. However, for this simple system, the manual closure of the contactor results in the motor starting. While inelegant and admittedly potentially dangerous for larger systems, the triggered manual override is effectively closing the primary contacts, as would an energized contactor coil. Lacking the pilot-level ladder logic holding circuit, the manual override must be continually triggered for the motor to remain energized. The moment the manual override is released, the contactor opens and the motor free spins to a halt. The behavior of the manual override is fundamentally and dangerously different when the pilot-level ladder logic is functional. As previously, the manual closure of the contactor results in the motor starting. However, when an operator releases the manual override, the contactor remains pulled in and the motor continues to run because the holding circuit has been established by the functional primary ladder logic. Recall that the movement of the contact carrier closes not only the primary L2T contacts, but also the auxiliary pilot level contacts associated with this particular contactor, notably the M1A holding contact. The holding circuit is established, and given pilot level ladder logic is functional, the holding circuit maintains the last asserted state. What can a technician do to stop this motor? Let's say the push button station, including the e-stop and stop button, is inaccessible, and the motor needs to be immediately brought to a halt, otherwise all hell will break loose. By all means, pause the lecture and think about this. You've only got 5 seconds to come up with an answer. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. The easy answer is to quite simply de-energize the contactor coil. The most immediately accessible means of doing so is to manually trigger the overload test button on the front of the overload relay. When the manually triggered contactor coil is de-energized, the holding circuit is broken and the motor free spins to a halt. While not necessarily a recommended or wise practice, this manual override demonstration just goes to show you that a technician truly knowledgeable of a system's function and construction can make it do what it is told or forced to do. Keep in mind, electrically controlled systems are not thinking systems, but merely soulless machines that respond to input and issue output. If you tell a system to drill a hole in your hand or force it to destroy itself, it will do so without a moment of hesitation or regret. For this reason, motor control devices are often installed in a rugged locking metal enclosure, thereby preventing untrained operators from manually overriding the electrically controlled system. All right, that is about that. Again, keep in mind there is no limit to the wrong that can happen. My intention in creating this resource was to introduce and familiarize you with a couple common troubleshooting scenarios you can put in your pocket and whip out at a later date. Remember, troubleshooting is not a skill separate from a thorough understanding of basic technical principles, but rather troubleshooting is the systematic and efficient application of basic technical principles. The first step to troubleshooting any system, no matter how complicated, is to understand how it is intended to operate in the first place. Anyone that tells you anything different is wrong. In conclusion, we examine some troubleshooting scenarios for the three-wire magnetic motor starter circuit. We examine the circuit's response to loss and restoration of both primary and pilot power, response to loss and restoration of primary motor power only, overload events in automatic and manual reset mode, malfunctioning holding circuits, and the surprising effects of manual overrides with and without pilot-level ladder logic. Thank you very much for your attention and interest, and we'll see you again during the next lecture of our series. Remember to tell your Lazy Lab partner about this resource, and be sure to check out the Big Bad Tech channel for additional resources and updates.